Meanwhile, the choir sings the anthem. Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anointed Solomon king.
Thank you.
ready for her anointing. She's been disrobed of her crimson robe. She's laid aside her diadem and jeweled color of the garter and her diamond necklace. And she has put on a simple white garment over her white satin gown, richly embroidered with emblems of Great Britain and the Commonwealth. For a moment she stands in this garment, so striking in contrast to the splendor that surrounds her. The canopy is placed over her by four knights of the garter. The Dean of Westminster brings to the Archbishop the ampulla, or eagle of beaten gold, containing the holy oil and the ancient spoon. Hidden from all eyes, the Archbishop goes beneath the canopy to anoint the Queen.
Be thy hands anointed with holy oil. Be thy breast anointed with holy oil. Be thy head anointed with holy oil, as kings and priests and prophets were anointed, and as Solomon was anointed king by Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet, so be thou anointed, blessed, and consecrated Queen over the peoples whom the Lord thy God hath given thee to rule and govern. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
After her anointing, the Queen comes from beneath the canopy. She kneels before the altar, and the Archbishop pronounces the blessing over her.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who by his Father was anointed with the oil of gladness above his fellows, by his holy anointing pour down upon your head and heart the blessing of the Holy Ghost, and prosper the work of your hands, that by the assistance of his heavenly grace you may govern and preserve the peoples committed to your charge in wealth, peace, and godliness. And after a long and glorious course of ruling a temporal kingdom wisely, justly, and religiously, you may at last be made partaker of an eternal kingdom through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Her Majesty has risen from before the altar and returned to King Edward's chair, from which the Knights of the Garter have removed the canopy. The simple white garment which Her Majesty wore for the anointing is removed. The Mistress of the Robes brings the Colobium Sindonis and the Super Tunica. The Dean of Westminster, assisted by the Mistress of the Robes, puts them upon the Queen. First, the Colobium Sindonis, the white robe of purity, a garment of fine white linen. Then, the Super Tunica, a close-fitting tunic of cloth of fine gold. Then, a girdle of cloth of gold. These robes resemble those worn by the emperors of Byzantium in the ancient world. Her Majesty is seated again in King Edward's chair. And now, as the consecrated monarch, the Queen receives one by one the emblems of Majesty. The Dean brings from the altar the golden spurs and delivers them to the Lord Great Chamberlain, who kneels before the Queen, offering the spurs on a velvet cushion. The spurs, the emblems of knighthood, His Majesty touches them, thereby recognizing chivalry and all that chivalry implies, and sends them back to the altar. the Marquis of Salisbury comes forward and receives the jeweled sword. The sword in a jewel-encrusted scabbard. He receives it from the Lord Chamberlain and delivers it to the Archbishop. The Archbishop lays it before him on the altar.
Hear our prayers, O Lord, we beseech thee, and so direct and support thy servant, Queen Elizabeth, that she may not bear the sword in vain, but may use it as the minister of God for the terror and punishment of evildoers and for the protection and encouragement of those that do well, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Archbishop takes the sword from the altar and, holding it high, brings it to King Edward's chair and delivers it into the Queen's right hand.
Receive this kingly sword, brought now from the altar of God and delivered to you by the hands of us, the bishops and servants of God, though unworthy. With this sword, do justice, stop the growth of iniquity, protect the Holy Church of God, help and defend widows and orphans, restore the things that are gone to decay, maintain the things that are restored, punish and reform what is amiss, and confirm what is in good order, that doing these things you may be glorious in all virtue, and so faithfully serve our Lord Jesus Christ in this life, that you may reign forever with him in the life which is to come.
Amen.
The Queen rises in the glittering tunic of the cloth of fine gold, and bareheaded she goes alone and in silence to the altar and offers the sword in the service of God. Her Majesty comes again to King Edward's chair. As she turns to be seated again in the chair, she faces for a moment the royal gallery, where her young son, Prince Charles, Duke of Cornwall, stands between Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, and Princess Margaret. He watches intently the splendor and the glory of her mother's coronation. The Marquis of Salisbury, the peer appointed to carry the sword, goes to the altar to redeem the sword and offers the price of it, 100 shillings, silver shillings in a bag, which is received by the Dean of Westminster in a golden basin. The Marquis of Salisbury moves down the altar steps and draws the sword from its scabbard. For the rest of the service, the sword is carried naked before the Queen. The Dean brings from the altar the armills or bracelets and delivers them to the Archbishop. These bracelets are an ancient attribute to kingship. It is 400 years since bracelets have been used as part of the regalia of the coronation. New bracelets this year have been presented by the governments of the Commonwealth. The Archbishop puts them upon the Queen's wrists.
Receive the bracelets of sincerity and wisdom, both as tokens of the Lord's protection embracing you on every side, and as symbols and pledges of the bond that unites you with your peoples, to the end that you may be strengthened in all your works and defended against all enemies, bodily and ghostly, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
The Queen rises from King Edward's chair. the groom of the robes, brings the stole royal and the robe royal or pall of cloth of gold to the Dean of Westminster. Assisted by the mistress of the robes, the Dean, standing before the chair, puts the stole about the Queen's shoulders, and then the robe royal. The imperial robe of gold resembling an ecclesiastical cope. The Lord Great Chamberlain fastens the clasps. And the Queen sits in King Edward's chair.
Receive this imperial robe, and the Lord your God endue you with knowledge and wisdom, with majesty and with power from on high. The Lord clothe you with the robe of righteousness and with the garments of salvation.
The Queen has now received all the vestments of majesty. The crown jewels are brought from the altar. First, the orb with the cross.
Receive this orb set under the cross, and remember that the whole world is subject to the power and empire of Christ our Redeemer.
For a moment, the Queen holds the orb in her right hand. She returns the orb to the Dean of Westminster, who lays it again upon the altar. The keeper of the jewel house brings to the Archbishop the Queen's ring, a ring bearing a sapphire and upon it a ruby cross, often called the wedding ring of England. The Archbishop puts it on the fourth finger of the Queen's right hand.
Receive the ring of kingly dignity and the seal of Catholic faith, and as thou art this day consecrated to be our head and prince, so may you continue steadfastly as the defender of Christ's religion, that being rich in faith and blessed in all good works, you may reign with him who is the King of Kings, to whom be the glory forever and ever.
Amen. The Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster, Lord Wilton, comes to King Edward's chair, bows, then kneels by the side of the Queen and presents the glove. The glove is a white kid with a hand lined with white silk. The gauntlet has a lining of royal red satin and is embroidered in gold thread, embracing the rose, thistle and shamrock with acorns and leaves of the British oak, and the royal cipher in coloured silk and gold thread on the back of the hand. The Queen puts the glove on her right hand. The Dean of Westminster brings the scepter with the cross and the rod with the dove.
Receive the royal scepter, the ensign of kingly power and justice. Receive the rod of equity and mercy. Be so merciful that you be not too remiss, so execute justice that you forget not mercy, punish the wicked, protect and cherish the just, and lead your people in the way wherein they should go.
The Queen holds the scepter in her right hand and the rod with the dove in her left. The moment of the Queen's crowning is near at hand. At a signal, the pages enter the theatre from all sides. They are wearing the livery colours of those they attend, and they bring the coronets to the Lord.
O God, the crown of the faithful, bless, we beseech thee, this crown, and so sanctify thy servant Elizabeth, upon whose head this day thou dost place it for a sign of royal majesty, that she may be filled by thine abundant grace with all princely virtues, through the King eternal, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. The Queen is still sitting in King Edward's chair. The princes and princesses, the peers and peeresses, prepare to put on their coronets and caps, and the kings of arms their crowns. The archbishop, assisted by other bishops, comes from the altar. The Dean of Westminster brings the crown. The archbishop takes it from the crimson cushion. He raises it high in the sight of the people and reverently places it on the Queen's head. Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth II, is crowned.
Righteousness, that having a right faith and manifold fruit of good works, you may obtain the crown of an everlasting kingdom by the gift of him whose kingdom endureth forever.
Amen.
Keep you, the Lord protect you in all your ways and prosper all your handiwork.
Amen.
The Lord give you faithful parliaments and quiet realms, sure defense against all enemies, fruitful lands and a prosperous industry, wise counselors and upright magistrates, leaders of integrity in learning and labor, a devout, learned, and useful clergy, honest, peaceable, and dutiful citizens.
Amen.
May wisdom and knowledge be the stability of your times, and the fear of the Lord your treasure.
Amen.
The Lord, who hath made you queen over these peoples, give you increase of grace, honor, and happiness in this world, and make you partaker of his eternal felicity in the world to come.
Amen.
The Archbishop moves from before King Edward's chair and turns to the whole congregation.
And the same Lord God Almighty grant that the clergy and nobles assembled here for this great and solemn service, and together with them, all the peoples of this commonwealth, fearing God and honoring the Queen, may by the gracious assistance of God's infinite goodness and by the vigilant care
of his anointed servant, our gracious sovereign, continually enjoy peace, plenty, and prosperity through Jesus Christ our Lord, unto whom the eternal Father and God the Holy Ghost be glory in the church, world without end.
Amen.
There comes now another ancient custom, the enthroning of Her Majesty. The great officers of state, those that bear the swords, and the nobles who carried the other regalia, move to the theater and stand around the throne. The throne of rose and gold is set upon a dais on the raised floor of the abbey. Into this throne, the queen will be lifted by those who attend her. This will recall the custom of the Anglo-Saxon kings of more than 1,000 years ago, who were lifted upon the shoulders of the nobles and enthroned upon a mound of earth in the sight of all the people. As Her Majesty is symbolically lifted into the throne, she takes possession of her kingdom. Her Majesty, wearing St. Edward's crown and carrying the scepter with the cross in her right hand and the rod with the dove in her left and wearing the robe royal, rises from King Edward's chair. And with the sword carried before her by the Marquis of Salisbury, she moves up the steps of the throne. Her Majesty is symbolically lifted into her throne. The Archbishop of Canterbury stands before her and exhorts Her Majesty in words virtually unchanged since William the Conqueror.
Stand firm and hold fast from henceforth the seat and state of royal and imperial dignity, which is this day delivered unto you in the name and by the authority of Almighty God and by the hands of us, the bishops and servants of God, though unworthy. And the Lord God Almighty, whose ministers we are, and the stewards of his mysteries, establish your throne in righteousness, that it may stand fast forevermore.
Amen.
The Queen has now been anointed, crowned, and enthroned. A solemn homage will now be done. The Queen delivers her scepter with the cross and the rod with the dove to the lords that carried them in the procession to hold till the homage is ended. First, the Archbishop of Canterbury ascends the steps of the throne and kneels before Her Majesty. The archbishops and bishops kneel in their places.
I, Geoffrey, Archbishop of Canterbury, will be faithful and true. Faith and truth will bear unto you, our sovereign lady, queen of this realm, and defender of the faith, and unto your heirs and successors according to law. So help me God.
The Archbishop kisses the Queen's right hand and ascends the steps. His Royal Highness, the Duke of Edinburgh, moves from his place takes off his coronet, which is held by a page. He ascends the steps of the throne, kneels before Her Majesty, and places his hand between the Queen's. He is the first to pronounce the words of homage.
I, Philip, do become your liege man of life and limb, and of earthly worship. In faith and truth I will bear unto you, to live and die, against all manner of folk, so help me God.
The Duke of Edinburgh rises, touches the crown upon Her Majesty's head, and kisses Her Majesty's left cheek. In the same manner, the royal dukes do their homage. First, the Duke of Gloucester, and then the Duke of Kent. Then the hereditary Earl Marshal of England, the Duke of Norfolk, will kneel before the Queen, and all the peers of his degree put off their coronets and kneel in their places. Duke of Norfolk rises, touches the crown, and kisses Her Majesty's hand. The senior peers of each degree, marquises, earls, viscounts, and barons, in like manner do their homage.
Thank you.
homage has been done, now the drum shall beat and the trumpet shall